Hi, everyone. My name is Anne Lieberman. I use they, them pronouns, and I'm the Director of Policy and Programs for Athlete Ally.
And my name is Brianna Turner. I use she, her pronouns, and I play for the Phoenix Mercury.
Brianna, thank you so, so much for joining us. I also want to say a big thank you to the NBA for bringing us to talk about trans inclusion in sport. I'm excited about this conversation. So want to tell folks a little bit about Athlete Ally in case you're not familiar with us. We are a national nonprofit organization that works to dismantle the structures of oppression that isolate, exclude, and endanger LGBTQ plus people in sport. And we do that in three primary ways. So the first is through education, the second is through policy advocacy, and the third is through athlete activism. And we have had the amazing opportunity to talk about trans inclusion in sport with teams, athletes, coaches across the country, and excited to do that here today. What are we going to be talking about in this session? Quick overview. We're going to show a quick video about an amazing young trans athlete named Rebecca. Then Brianna and I are going to run through some basic language around transgender experience and identity, so we're all on the same page. Then we're going to talk a little bit about the current landscape for transgender youth in the US. And then Brianna and I are going to get to dig in a little bit deeper and talk about allyship. And then we're going to close with some concrete next steps. All right. So now we're going to watch this video about a young girl named Rebecca. And this is just a really wonderful window into Rebecca's life and why sports is so important to Rebecca.
Ever since I was a kid, I always had a passion to make the world a better place. I'm Rebecca, I'm 14 years old. I am a nerd, I love school, I read a lot, and yeah, I just love to laugh.
Rebecca is a bright and sassy 14-year-old girl with a big heart and a love of life.
I've been playing field hockey for 4 years now. The concept is so fun because you get like to have a stick and you get to hit a ball with it.
Then you would pass the ball to Devin.
I also really love the people that I'm always surrounded with and the community that I create. Such a tight-knit group.
Rebecca's really good at a lot of things. She, you know, aces her schoolwork with very little effort. She's great in music and theater. She doesn't have to try really hard. And so sports are this place where she does have to work hard. She learns a lot from not being the best and from really having to commit to get better at something.
When we're on the field, my teammates, they just see me as me. They see me as a teammate who they're going to play with, who they're going to win with, who they're going to lose with, and just someone who they're going to work with together. Yay!
She's
Dang,
just
found
a normal girl that yeah. A friend. And you're the most bubbly person.
Yeah,
so.
No, you are.
Yeah, whenever you need a laugh, you go to Rebecca.
Rebecca wouldn't play sports if she had to play on a boys' team because she's a girl. She belongs on the girls' team. To say, oh, you belong in every way throughout the day. We see you, you're a girl, this is your life, these are your friends. Oh, but not on the athletic field. It doesn't make any sense.
I would worry about my friends and the other kids in my school because I know what it's like to have my gender questions, to have to be, to prove I'm a girl, and I don't want them to have to go through that because it's violating and embarrassing.
When you don't understand something, it can be scary, and when we react out of fear, then we can do really harmful things. The only people who should be afraid of Rebecca are her little brothers, perhaps, because like any good big sister, she terrorizes them at times. My kid is just a kid. She wants to go to school, have fun with her friends, and play sports just like anybody else.
Sports are something that I really like doing. I'm so much more than trans. That doesn't make me less of a girl. It doesn't make me less of a human either. I'm just me.
Oh, that video gets me every time. There are so many kids in the US like Rebecca who just want to play sports with their friends. And Rebecca's story is not unique in that way. And I know for me as a non-binary person who grew up and didn't have the language to understand my identity, the thing I did understand was that sports always made me feel so welcomed and comfortable. And it was really one of the only places for me growing up that I felt safe, where the bullying stopped for a second and I could be myself. And I don't know who I would be today without sports. And Brianna, I know some of that is similar for you too. So I'm just curious if you have any thoughts or reactions you want to share with that video.
Yeah, sports have been such a big part of my life. I started playing at the YMCA when I was 5 years old. So I've been playing organized sports for 20 years now. And I would definitely say my life would not be the same without sports. From team building to accountability, I think sports just really just have so many different things to bring to the table, and everyone should be able to participate in them. Sometimes people don't feel like they know the right words to use or even understand what it means to be transgender. And can you take us through some of the terms that would be helpful to know?
Yeah, absolutely. So we also put together a words to know glossary for folks. Everyone will have access to it. So don't worry if you can't remember every single word or all the terminology right now. So let's start with gender identity. We all have a gender identity. Gender identity is essentially one's deeply held sense of being a woman, a man, some of both, or neither. And one's gender identity doesn't always correspond to their sex assigned at birth. And people experience awareness of their gender identity at different points in their lives. Usually it's very early on in life, but it might shift over time. We also hear the term cisgender a lot. So cisgender are people whose gender identity is the same as the gender they were assigned at birth. So to use Brianna as an example, Brianna was assigned female at birth and identifies as a woman. Now we'll get into sex assigned at birth. So sex assigned at birth is just the sex that is assigned to an infant at birth, usually by a doctor or medical staff, based on the infant's visible anatomy. So that includes genitalia, other physical characteristics. Sex assigned at birth is often male or female. Some of you might have also heard the terms biological man or biological woman. We want to stay away from using those terms and instead use assigned female or assigned male at birth. And that's because saying assigned is a recognition that someone else, often a member of the medical community, is making a decision for someone else about their gender identity. And sex assignment may or may not align with someone's gender identity, even from a very early age. All right, moving on to transgender. So transgender is an umbrella term used to describe people whose gender identity differs from the sex they were assigned at birth. Trans folks span all communities, come from a variety of different backgrounds, ethnicities, ages, abilities. Trans people, just like all people, are not a monolith. We want to stay away from using terms like transgendered with the ED or a transgender or transsexual. Some of these terms might have been used in the past, but language is evolving and shifting. And so we want to just say a transgender person.
And what about gender expression?
Yeah, so gender expression is the way in which a person communicates their gender to others through external means, so like clothing, hairstyles, and or mannerisms.
Okay. And also hear people talking about transitioning. What exactly does that mean?
Yeah, so transition can be really confusing for a lot of people, especially in this whole conversation about trans athletes and youth sports. Not a simple answer, because transition can mean many different things. I think the most important thing to note is that there is no single right way to transition, and transitioning is deeply personal. So there are different parts of a transition that transgender people may or may not choose to do. So for example, one can socially transition. So that means changing a name, pronouns, clothing style or expression that we just talked about, bathrooms use, et cetera, someone can make a medical transition, which would be medical interventions like hormones, gender affirming surgeries. Someone can also make a legal transition, which would be legally changing a name, changing documents like an ID, a social security card, a passport, a birth certificate, et cetera. So people can do some of these things. They can do all of these things. People might not be able to transition in different ways for a number of different reasons. So for example, some states don't allow trans folks to change gender markers on IDs. Some people can't afford or don't have access to gender affirming healthcare. So it's important to also understand that context and that the validity of someone's gender identity doesn't depend on any social, legal, or medical transition. Someone's self-identification is what validates that identity. And then before we wrap up this terminology section, there are two other terms we want to cover really briefly. So the first is intersex. Intersex people are born with sex characteristics that don't fit medical norms for female or male bodies. And when we talk about sex characteristics, we're talking about physical features relating to sex, like chromosomes, genitals, gonads, hormones, and other reproductive anatomy and secondary features that emerge from puberty. And then non-binary is something that is a term that people are hearing more and more as well. And that refers to people who identify as neither a man or a woman, both a man and a woman, or a combination of a man and a woman. And it's a term that some people use exclusively. So some folks might only say or use the term non-binary, while others might use it interchangeably with terms like genderqueer, gender non-conforming, gender diverse, or gender expansive. I know those were a lot of terms. Those are all also defined in the glossary, so don't worry. People who identify as non-binary might also understand their identity as falling under the trans umbrella as well. So for example, I identify as non-binary and trans because my gender identity doesn't match my sex assigned at birth. And I don't identify as being a cisgender person. Today, we're not going to focus on non-binary athletes or athletes with intersex variations because each of those are really big topics and we would need so much more time to talk about those as well. Our focus here really will be on trans athletes and trans kids who want to play sports because of the current legislation targeting them and the debate around their participation in sport in the US and also across the globe.
Thanks for that, Anne. We learned a lot of new terminology. So what is it like to be a trans kid in the US right now?
Whew, it is tough. This is a tough moment for trans kids. Trans youth face an uphill battle in almost every part of their lives. 84% of trans kids feel unsafe at school, with 70% of those kids avoiding bathrooms altogether because they feel safe or uncomfortable. So what this means is a lot of trans kids, because they're afraid to go to the bathroom in school, won't drink water because they don't want to use the bathroom. Nearly half of trans youth attempt suicide, and the trans community, as we're seeing right now, is increasingly the target of violence and harassment. And then when we look at LGBTQ plus youth and access to sport, and trans youth and access to sport, LGBTQ plus kids are far less likely than their cisgender peers to participate in sport. And according to a study that was done in 2019 by the Human Rights Campaign, 60% of all youth played a sport, but only 14% of trans boys and 12% of trans girls played sports. And then finally, sports is such a powerful tool for fighting depression, building community, and cultivating lasting self-confidence. And it's just so important that kids have access to sport. And a recent report from the Trevor Project noted that trans and non-binary youth who have access to a gender-affirming space at school, like a sports team, have 25% reduced odds of reporting a suicide attempt within a year. So sports is literally a lifeline for kids. doing a little bit of a deeper dive into the current landscape, you know, Brianna is someone who has been vocal about her support of trans athletes and about the real barriers for women athletes in access to opportunities in sport. Here's what we know. Much of the conversation about trans kids in sport is focused on trans girls. We all love women's sports and want women's sports to thrive, and we can keep sport safe and fair and still welcome trans athletes on our teams. So with that, there are a few important facts we want to underscore. So the first is the conversation about trans athletes is a solution in search of a problem. The second is that policies for trans athletes exist and have existed for decades with no issues. The third is there are actual challenges women and girls face in sport, and trans athletes are not among them. And so this is where we get to dig in a little bit deeper too with you, is this is one of my favorite series of tweets of all time. I told you this week that we use it in our educational programming. So can you talk a little bit about this? What prompted this series of tweets, and why did it feel important to speak out about this?
Well, for me, obviously, with the NCAA Women's Basketball Tournament, it was trending. We all saw the weight room differences, how the men had a huge weight room and the women, for 64 teams, they got one rack of dumbbells and like a dozen yoga mats, which was literally so unacceptable. And previously, I know a couple of days before that happened, I saw a lot of people talking about women's sports, but they were talking about it in a way that excluded trans women. So that was really confusing. And they were disguising as they're caring for women's sports. So now we have the NCAA issue, weight room come up. And I was like, okay, well, all these people that were so adamant about caring for women's sports have suddenly disappeared. And I'm trying to figure out where you guys went. So, and that's when I just thought to make my tweet about it. And it got a lot more traction than I thought. Like, it had got so many retweets and replies, good and bad. But I thought it was just good to get that out there, that you wanting to support women's sports shouldn't be at the expense of trans women. We all need more encouragement in the sport and more people watching. Like, your empowerment of women cannot exclude trans women.
Yes, 100%. And we're going to dig more into your allyship in a second. So in wrapping this section up, the next piece is when we look at transphobia and how it presents itself in the US and globally, we know that it's inextricably linked with racism. And this is an amazing excerpt from an activist named Amru Al-Qadi, who speaks to this so eloquently. And when we look at media representation of trans athletes, the majority of trans athletes who have been in the news and under incredible scrutiny have been young Black and brown trans women. And the last piece and why we're all here is that trans kids are kids and they only want to play sports with their friends. All right, so back to allyship. Your tweets got so much traction. They were amazing. And we've seen other pro athletes, celebrities speak up on trans inclusion. So why do you think we've seen this conversation come to a head now?
I think it's really just been trending so much more now than it has in the past. We see from different bills being passed from different states, more people coming out as trans, more professional athletes coming out as trans. So I think people are really now starting to really pay attention and educate themselves and really focus in on it.
Yeah, I totally agree. And what are some concrete ways that coaches and teammates can make teams feel inclusive for LGBTQ plus kids, but especially trans kids?
Definitely making sure it's a safe space. Maybe talk to your team about team values you guys might want to have. Maybe knowing everyone's pronouns if they feel comfortable sharing. And just making sure that it's a very safe space and making sure there's accountability. So if someone hears something, they say something, because everyone should be welcomed on the field, on the ice, on the court. It should be a very welcoming space in the competitive space as well.
Yeah, absolutely. And you've been an amazing source of support for Lasia too. Do you want to talk a little bit about that?
Yes. So Lasia plays for the New York Liberty. And early this year, she came out as trans. And I had nothing but support for her. We weren't even that close prior to her coming out, but ever since then, I'm always like looking at her articles, retweeting her, giving her my support, knowing that I have her back. And obviously, like, she's the first person in WBA to come out as trans. So I'm just always making sure that she knows that she has an ally in me. And I'm always happy to speak up for her to make sure that people get their facts right.
Yeah, the support of so many teams and so many players for Alaysia has been incredible. So thank you for sharing that. All right, so let's talk about some next steps. So Athlete Ally is gonna have a booth at the Virtual Expo Hall. We're gonna have a bunch of resources for you all to take back and use with your team. So definitely check us out there. Please follow Athlete Ally and Chris Mosier across all social media platforms. We've been really lucky to do a ton of work with Chris this year on trans inclusion education trainings. And he is just such an amazing athlete, activist, and resource in this space. Support women athletes in women's sports. Go watch games, buy merch, watch women's sports on TV. Brianna, what else am I missing? What else can folks do?
We go out to bars, tell people to stream the games anywhere, stream, get our viewership up, tell your friends to watch. Yeah, just support them. Support us.
Yeah. And then last but not least, reach out with questions. My email is up there. Please. I'm a resource. Athlete Ally is a resource. And then last thing, diversify your social media. This is an incredible list of trans and non-binary athletes and influencers that you can follow. It's a great way to just keep learning, keep asking questions, and keep sharing what you learn with folks in your networks. So with that, just want to say thank you to everyone. Brianna, thank you so much. You're amazing. Thank you for joining us.
Thank you.
Any
for that.
Last words?
Support trans kids and fight for them. They deserve everything cis people get too.